Amen. Hey, if you need a Bible, ushers come forward with Bibles. And we are in Gospel of John, coming towards the end, John chapter 18. And we're looking at the title of my message is Learning from Peter's Mistakes. Now, Apostle Peter, one of my favorite characters in the New Testament. Love the guy. He was a man's man. We saw last week, in our scene last week, remember? They had a cohort, 600 soldiers come to arrest Jesus. And what did Peter do? He jumped in front of Jesus and cut the guy's ear off. And you know what? I don't know if you've ever done Bible studies or led a Bible study or whatever. I was thinking after the Bible study last week about Peter cutting the guy's ear off. I missed the point that I wanted to give you guys that, and I'm kicking myself after the service saying, you remember last week we talked about that one of the principles there is put the sword away. When people are betraying you, put the sword away. Don't fight back. And instead of cutting somebody's ear off, what do you do when someone's betraying you? You overcome evil with good, right? You love your enemy. You pray for those who persecute you. And last week, we saw Jesus, after Peter cut the guy's ear off, what did Jesus do? He put it back on. That's right. I want to get to heaven and see the video vault of this, if there's video vault in heaven. And can you imagine? He takes the guy's ear off the ground, and then he puts it back on the guy's head, and it's totally reconnected and healed. This is the guy that came to arrest Jesus, the one that's persecuting Jesus, the one that's going to be a part of killing Jesus. And what does Jesus do for him? Doesn't take a sword out. He takes his hand out, and he heals his ear. That's the example of Christ, overcoming evil with good. But now Peter, man's man, takes the sword. And one of the things I like about Peter, too, is he was just bold. He was bold. Remember when Jesus was walking on water? As he's walking on water, Peter says, "Hey, Master, bid that I come to you too." And he jumps out of the boat and walks on water with Jesus. It's awesome. And then also when Jesus was asking, who do you say that I am to his disciples? Peter's the one that stepped up. And Peter said, "You are the Lord, the Christ." And Jesus made those great words, declaration to Peter, your name now is the rock, Peter. And upon this rock, the rock of your confession of me being the Christ, I'm going to build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Peter was a man's man. I like him. But Peter also was a man that made mistakes. You know, go back to just the walking on the water. After he got in the water, instead of keeping his eyes on Jesus, he started looking around at the waves. And what happened to the rock? He sank like a rock. He just started sinking until Jesus rescued him and pulled him back up again. Also, Peter, interesting, right after he confessed Jesus as the Christ, the Lord and the Christ, next scene in Scripture is he tries to talk Jesus out of going to the cross. It says in Matthew 16:22, Peter took him aside, took Jesus aside, and began to rebuke him. Really? Rebuking Jesus? Not a good idea, Peter. Saying, "God forbid it, Lord, this shall never happen to you." But he turned and said to Peter, what's he say to Peter here? "Get behind me, Satan." Wow. "You're a stumbling block to me, for you're not setting your mind on God's interest, but man's." Can you imagine the roller coaster there? One minute you're the rock. One minute you're making a confession that the whole church is going to be built on. Next minute, next scene, all of a sudden, you're being called Satan by Jesus himself. That's one reason I love Peter. I can relate to him. I can relate to the successes and the failures. I can relate to one minute doing the right thing and the next minute doing the wrong thing. And don't look at me like that. You do the same thing. Right? And we can relate to Peter in that way. We can relate to, he was a man's man. He was bold. But sometimes he just really, really blew it. We're going to see that today. We're going to see him deny Christ 3 times. We're going to see his denial, but we're going to learn from his denial some truths, some practical principles that'll help us learn from his mistakes. You see, there's 2 ways you can go. You could just make your own mistakes, or you can learn from other people's mistakes. I prefer to learn from other people's mistakes and not to have to make those mistakes myself. Amen? So let's learn from Peter's mistakes. Let's jump right in. We left off in John chapter 18, verse 12. If you're there, say amen. I don't know if you said amen. Come on. All right, John 18:12. What does it say? So the Roman cohort, again, how many people in a cohort? 600. It was 1/10 of a legion. A legion was 6,000. So 600 soldiers, And that commander and the officers of the Jews arrested Jesus. So he's arrested now, and they bound him. Now, question. Were these ropes really binding Jesus Christ? He said he could call 12 legions, 72,000 angels to stop the whole thing. They could just, bam, split those ropes up. What held Jesus Christ in a bound position? It was his love. Were the nails on the cross really what held Jesus on the cross? No, it was his love. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross. The only thing that brought him to the cross bound was his love. He was bound by his love for you and me. And that's why it says in Hebrews 12:2, for the joy set before him, he endured the cross. It was a joy to him because he loves you so much. And the only reason why he submitted to being bound by his own creations is because the only way we could be forgiven was for him to go to a cross and die for your sins. And if you believe in him, you're forgiven. You're free. You're not under condemnation. You're under grace because he was bound for you. Why should we live for Jesus? Because he died for you. He went all the way to the cross and never looked back, bound by love. And then it says this, verse 13, and he led him to Annas first, for he was father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was the high priest that year. Now Caiaphas was the one who advised the Jews that it was expedient for one man to die on behalf of the people. Now, two characters here. There's Annas, who is the high priest presently, and there was Caiaphas. And Annas first, he was the father-in-law, and then Caiaphas, who was the present high priest. So there's two people here. There was the high priest emeritus. He had been the high priest previously, who is the father-in-law now of this other gentleman who is the present high priest. Both of these guys were partners in crime. Why? What did Jesus do at the very beginning of his ministry and the very end of his ministry? He went into the temple, and he cleared out the temple because there was money changers ripping off God's people. And Jesus said this, my Father's house should be called a house of prayer, and you've made it a robber's den. Now, who was the leadership? It was these two guys. And they were ripping off God's people, money changing in God's temple, and they had a racket going. They had animals for sacrifices. They charged several times what they were worth, and you'd bring your own sacrifices in, and they'd always find a blemish on your sacrifice, so you can't bring that one, you got to buy ours. And they're charging just exorbitant prices. And Jesus cleared them out of the temple. And that's one reason why they arrested Jesus and wanted to kill Jesus. Jesus was hurting their bottom line. He's driving those money changers out of the temple. And these two individuals, Annas and Caiaphas, were a big part of that. Now, verse 15, Simon Peter was following Jesus. So was another disciple. Now, that disciple was known to the high priest and entered with Jesus into the court of the high priest. Now, this other disciple, most scholars believe it's John, the writer of this gospel. Why? Because he was a son of Zebedee. Zebedee had a fishing business that was very prosperous to the point that he exported fish from the Sea of Galilee all the way to Jerusalem. It was a delicacy in those days, salted fish from the Sea of Galilee. And many scholars believe that John knew the high priest and the leadership there because he was a delivery boy for his dad's business. And so he was in with these guys. And so these guys let John now into the doorway where they're going after Jesus Christ. So the other disciple who was known to the high priest went out, spoke to the doorkeeper, brought Peter in. And then the slave girl who kept the door said to Peter, you're not also one of this man's disciples, are you? And Peter said, first denial, what does he say? I am not. He's going to deny Jesus three times in this story. What happened? How could he, this rock, this man's man, the one that cut the guy's ear off, deny Jesus? And it starts with a slave girl, just a girl. I'm sorry, ladies. But it's a slave girl, and he's backing off and saying, don't know the guy. Not associated with him. Now, let me tell you, there are some things on the trail to his failure that led to his failure. Always is. When someone has a major fall, there's usually things that lead up. Compromises, mistakes, things done wrong that lead to the failure. And so let's look at a few of those. And let's look at some other gospels to see what led to Peter's fall. It's important for us to see this so we don't let these things lead to our falls also. So we don't betray Jesus Christ with our words or our lifestyles also. So first thing that led to his fall was overconfidence and pride. Listen to Mark chapter 14, verses 27 to 31. It should be up on the screen. It says, Jesus said to them, This is at the very night he's to be arrested. You will all fall away because it is written, I will strike down the shepherd and the sheep will be scattered. But after I've been raised, I will go ahead of you to Galilee. Notice Peter. But Peter said to him, even though all may fall away, what's he say? Yet I will not. And Jesus said to him, truly I say to you, that this very night before a rooster crows twice, you yourself will deny me three times. But Peter kept saying insistently, even if I have to die with you, I'm not going to deny you. And they're all saying the same thing also. Now, in another gospel, Peter said this. He said, if all these other guys deny you, fine. I will never deny you, and I will die with you. What does Peter do? Denies Christ three times. Overconfidence and pride will lead to a fall. 1 Corinthians 10 says, he who thinks he stands, better what? Take heed, lest he fall. Listen to Proverbs on this. Proverbs 16:18 says, pride goes before destruction, and a haughty spirit before stumbling. Pride and overconfidence will leave you in a ditch, because God is opposed to the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. And it's very important for us to understand that. If we start saying, well, I got this thing figured out, I'll never do that. Well, that person might make a mistake like that. They might deny Christ in that way, but I'll never do that. And you let your guard down, and when you let your guard down, you're about to get popped. Grace. Grace is important, but we need to realize that pride and overconfidence will lead to a fall. A haughty spirit goes before a fall. It's important for us to understand that, because sometimes we start growing spiritually, sometimes we start advancing, and we start maturing, and the next thing we know, we fall into spiritual pride and say, well, they might do that again, but I'll never do that, except for the grace of God. There go you. Always keep your guard up. Never say never. Never think that you got a pass on this thing called sin, because you don't. There's a real enemy. He's come to kill, steal, and destroy. Satan is prowling around like a roaring lion, looking for people to devour, you and me. But greater is he that is in us than he that's in the world. We're more than conquerors, church, but we got to keep our guard up. We can't get into this mode of, I got this figured out. I got this. I'll never do that again. Bam! He'll sucker punch you if you don't keep your guard up. Our U-turn for Christ, great ministry. But one of the things, we have guys from all over the country come for our U-turn for Christ. I mean, we got guys come from Washington, New Jersey, Florida, and they come, and they get their lives together, and it's drastic change. I love seeing it. But when they go back to Florida or New Jersey, if they have a wife and kids, many of them go back to their home states and their home environments, and one of the first things I tell them, if I have interaction before they leave with any of them, I'll tell them this. Please, number one, when you get back to your homes, stay in fellowship. Two are better than one, and a cord of three strands is not easily broken. Get involved in a church and be all in that church. You need other Christians around you for accountability, safety, and strength. But then the second thing I'll tell them, keep your guard up. Don't ever think you got this thing figured out, because you don't until you get to heaven. And the good we want to do, we don't do. And what we don't want to do, a lot of times we'll do. If we're not careful, keep your guard up. Again, humility, very important part of not failing. Listen to what Peter said in his later years. He talked about humility, 1 Peter 5, 5 through 6. You younger men, likewise, be subject to your elders and all of you. Notice what he says. Clothe yourselves with what? Humility toward one another, for God is opposed to the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you at the proper time. Don't fall into pride and overconfidence. Just stay humble and keep your guard up. Second mistake Peter made is the dude was sleeping when he should have been praying. Look at the story. Go back to the Gospels, Matthew chapter 26, 36 to 41. It says, then Jesus came with them to a place called Gethsemane. That's the Garden of Gethsemane, right by the Mount of Olives, and said to his disciples, sit here while I go over there to pray. And he took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, and began to be grieved and distressed. And then he said to them, my soul is deeply grieved to the point of death. Remain here and keep watch with me. Went a little bit beyond them, fell on his face and prayed, my Father, if it's possible, let this cup pass from me, yet not as I will, but as you will. And he came to the disciples and found them, what? Sleeping, and said to Peter specifically, so you men could not keep watch with me for 1 hour? Keep watching and praying that you may not enter in temptation. The spirit is willing, but what? flesh is weak, man. And if we want to overcome our flesh and live in the Spirit, we need to be watching and praying. I've never seen a victorious, strong Christian that's overcoming in their life that wasn't a person of prayer. Always. When there's strength, when there's power, when there's victory, there's prayer. Remember what Jesus said earlier in John 15? I'm the vine, you are the branches. If any man abides in me, I'll abide in him, and he will produce much fruit. But apart from me, what? You got nothing. You can do nothing. But I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. Amen? We need to live in that strength. But that strength comes from being connected to the power source. And the power source is Jesus Christ himself. We need to abide in him so he can abide in us. And we can have the power to overcome these attacks that come upon all of us. You know, the Bible says, 1 Thessalonians 5:17, pray without ceasing. All the time we should be praying. We should be shooting up arrow prayers all throughout our days. We should make prayer how we begin the day and end the day. As we have private prayer, we're going to have public power. We're going to overcome these things that are being thrown at us on a regular basis because we have the power of prayer to strengthen us. Our power source is Jesus, but we need to be connected to our power source in prayer. It says in Ephesians chapter 6, our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the powers, against the world forces of this darkness, against the spiritual forces of wickedness in the heavenly places. Then it gives us a whole list of different spiritual armor and tools that we have. But at the end of the list, after talking about the shield of faith and the belt of truth, helmet of salvation, and you know the sword of the Spirit and the gospel boots, after all these different tools we have, it ends with prayer. And it says this, Ephesians chapter 6, 18, with all prayer and petition, pray at all times in the Spirit, and with this in view, be on the alert, with all perseverance and petition for all the saints. You want more public power? You want victory? You want to be a victor instead of a victim? Be a person of prayer. Private prayer leads to public power. And when you get in that place of prayer and you depend on the Lord, man, you get it. You get that power and you get that victory you need to overcome those things that we all face. Prayer. Prayer. When we work, we work. But when we pray, God works. It's awesome. Awesome. So second thing was he was falling asleep when he should have been praying. Interesting also, he was following Jesus at a distance. That's another thing that led to his failure. Look at Luke 22. If you have your Bibles, look at Luke 22, verse 54. It says this, same story, parallel account. It says, having arrested Jesus, they led him away, brought him to the house of the high priest, but Peter was following at a what? Instead of staying by Jesus' side and staying close to Jesus, he was staying apart and following just at a distance. That's important for us to see because there's a lot of Christians, especially in our culture, that just kind of want to follow Jesus at a distance. So I'll go to church. I'll go to church every Sunday, but during the week, I'll just kind of not be fanatical about this thing. I'll just kind of keep my distance a little bit and kind of just flow with the world, right? That's a dangerous position to be in because you know what? When you're half-hearted like that, you flow with the world more than you flow with Jesus oftentimes. You know, the Bible makes it very clear. We're supposed to be in the world, but we're not supposed to be of it. The Bible makes it very clear. We're to be a holy people, a people that are God's own possession, a people that are different than the world and are following Jesus wholeheartedly. Bible says, Bible makes it very clear. Either we're to be hot or cold. If you're lukewarm, Jesus says, I just want to spit you out of my mouth. Literally translated, I just want to vomit you out of my mouth. Oh, it's kind of a sick picture, but it makes Jesus nauseated being half-hearted Christians. You know, I'm a Clemson fan. Sorry, but I am. If you're a Gamecock, I'm a Clemson fan. Someone reminded me, I mentioned this in the first service, you're a Clemson fan because you had four kids all go to Clemson, but every time you talk about being a Clemson fan, you wear Carolina colors. I didn't even know that. It must be some subconscious thing or something to be on both sides of the, whatever. But one thing about I like about Dabo, the coach of Clemson, is he's come up with this phrase, all in, right? And he wants his players, he wants his fans, he wants, let's be all in. And the thing I like about Dabo, too, is the dude's all in. Just watch him on the sidelines when he's coaching. I think he's going to have a heart attack every time they get a touchdown. I mean, he's like, oh, like this, and he's hugging guys, and he's slapping guys on the back, and it's just, he's all in. He is all in. And you know what? I like that about Dabo because that's how I want to be as a Christian. I want to be all in. I don't want to be this half-hearted following Jesus from a distance. I'll follow him when it's expedient for me to be in church on Sunday, but the rest of the week, I'm just going to stay a distance. No, man, I want to be a fanatic for Jesus. I want to be all in. You know what? I heard one person say one time, you know what a fanatic for Jesus, if you say someone's a fanatic for Jesus, you know what that is? You know what that means? It means they probably just love Jesus more than you do. I like that. Let's be people that are on fire, not lukewarm, but all in. Amen? Let's just leave that for a football game. Let's make that our Christianity. We are all in. We're not going to be at this distance from Jesus. We're going to be what? We're going to be what? Oh, that was half-hearted. We're going to be what?
All in.
All in. Amen. Say to your neighbor, I'm all in.
All in.
Come on. We're all in. We're wholehearted. We're going to be going 100% at this thing. We're not going to compromise. We're not going to be half-hearted. We're going to be all. We're not going to follow Jesus, chameleon Christian, camouflage Christian. No, we're going to be all in. We're going to be all in. And there's power in that. And it'll help you not to fall, and it will help you stay away from failure if you're all in. You know, people think it's dangerous being a fanatic for Jesus. You know what's dangerous? What's dangerous is being a half-hearted Christian. Because what do half-hearted Christians do? Is they stay on a fence. And what happens on a fence? You're going to fall. You got one foot in the world, one foot in Jesus, and the scary thing about that, too, is you got too much of Jesus to enjoy the world and too much of the world to enjoy Jesus. Let's just be all in. Let's be all in. All right, so let's go on now. Look at verse 18. Now the slaves and the officers were standing there having made a charcoal fire, for it was cold, and they were warming themselves, and Peter was also with them standing and warming himself. Here's the next mistake on the trail to the fall. He's warming himself at the enemy's fire. These are soldiers and slaves that have come to arrest Jesus Christ. They're the enemies of Christ, and Peter is hanging out, not only associating, but warming himself at their fire. And church, we gotta be careful with our associations. We gotta be careful where we're going for comfort and warmth also. The world has all kinds of broken cisterns you can warm yourself by. Alcohol, drugs, immorality, pornography, wrong, immoral relationships. Find comfort in that, warm yourself by that, you're headed for destruction, you're headed for fall. Also, please, Christians, listen to me, please be careful with your associations. Now, does that mean you're in a holy huddle and you have no non-Christian friends? No, you're going to be the salt of the earth. You're going to be the light of the world. But influence them. Don't let them influence you. The Bible says bad company, man, it corrupts good morals. And be careful with those associations. Your best friends should be Christians. Your best friends should be people that are actually supporting you and encouraging you and set an example for you and are saying, hey, follow me as I follow Christ. And that's what we need to be for other people too. You know, we did this 30th anniversary trip, Heidi and I, for a couple weeks. It was awesome. Had a wonderful family time. I had all 10 of us together, all my kids and their significant others. It was a wonderful, wonderful, probably one of our best times ever as a family. But one of the things that made it special for me, too, is not only my family, but I shared with it last week, the guy that I helped lead to Christ 25 years ago is the guy that kind of opens the door for us over there, and he does property rental, and he just really provides a wonderful, he's like a host for us when we go over there. But I got to have two different meals with him, and he's all in. I mean, he's on fire. The last 25 years, he's been on fire for Christ ever since he came to Christ. And I was thinking, I got the chance to lead him to Christ, but just spending time with him and fellowshipping with him, it strengthened me. It encouraged me and inspired me because of the way he leads a basketball camp for several dozen, I think a couple hundred kids every summer. He brings in Christian ball players, and they give their testimony and devotions, and he's reaching kids, middle school kids, all across the island every summer, and he's passionate about it. God's using him in a mighty way. And being around him, associated with him, just built me up the whole time I had time with Dan Williams over there. It's wonderful. And then the guy we bumped into in a restaurant over there, the guy that led me to Christ 38 years ago. It's amazing. And I got to have breakfast with him the next day with his wife and my wife Heidi, and then we got to go snorkeling together, and we just hung out. And just walking on the beach with him, having breakfast with him, talking to him about the Lord, he's all in still too. He's been a Christian for almost 50 years. He got saved when he was 7 years old, and he's been on fire ever since. He's led dozens and dozens and dozens of people to Christ personally, including me. And just spending time with that guy at lunch was awesome. And having breakfast with him, it was just wonderful because it's like the fire's there, and when there's fire, the fire spreads. And that's what fellowship does. But vice versa is true too. You get around the wrong people, and you stay around the wrong people, and bad company corrupts good morals. And that's what's happening to Peter. He's hanging out with the enemy's fire, finding his comfort there, and that association helps to bring him down. You understand what I'm saying, church? And I think we need to examine our friendships and make sure we have some solid, godly friendships of people that will spur us on to love and good deeds and stimulate us to be the Christians we're called to be. It's a big part of what fellowship's for. And so it goes on now, verse 19. The high priest then questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his teaching. And Jesus answered him and said, I have spoken openly to the world. I always taught in synagogues and in the temple where all the Jews come together. And I spoke nothing in secret. Why do you question me? Question those who have heard what I spoke to them. They know what I said. Now, interesting, the law of Judaism at the time, they had a law that you couldn't question the accused until you questioned the witnesses. So what are these religious leaders doing? They're breaking their own law. They're questioning Jesus first instead of getting two or three witnesses that could bring the accusations against him. Not only that, there was a part of the law, too, was a Fifth Amendment, kind of what we have where you can't tell on yourself. You have to have two or three witnesses telling you, and you weren't supposed to. You had the right of just staying quiet. So Jesus is kind of, in a way, reminding them of that law. And then when he said this, verse 22, one of the officers standing nearby struck Jesus, saying, is that the way you answer the high priest? And Jesus answered him, if I had spoken wrongly, testify of the wrong. But if rightly, why do you strike me? And so Anna sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Can you imagine? This is God in the flesh. His creation, bam, slapping him like that. And this was against the Judaizers' laws also, or the Judaism law also, because law at the time, including the Talmud, said that if you are accused of something, you couldn't be punished or struck until you had an official trial. They're breaking the law again. They're striking Jesus before any kind of official trial. And Jesus is reminding them of that. Now, let's close it up now. Verse 25. Now, Simon Peter was standing. What's he doing? Warming himself by the enemy's fire again. And so they said to him, you're not one of these disciples, are you? He denied it. Second time, I am not. And then one of the slaves of the high priest, being a relative of the one whose ear Peter cut off, said, did I not see you in the garden with him? This is interesting. The guy who got his ear cut off, his relatives, I can't forget a guy like you that cuts my cousin or whoever's ear off. You're with Jesus, aren't you? And Peter then denied it again. And immediately, what happens? A rooster crowed. Just like Jesus said, the rooster would crow. The rooster crowed. Interesting, Gospel of Luke. Jesus, as soon as Peter denied him the third time, looks across the courtyard. And he locked eyes with Peter. Can you imagine? Now, question. What do you think were in Jesus' eyes after Peter denied him the third time? And he locked eyes with Peter. Condemnation? Laying a guilt trip on Peter? I don't think so. I think it was eyes of compassion. Remember, he said earlier, he said, Peter, Satan has demanded to sift you like wheat. You're going to go through a real trial coming up this very night. But Peter, I prayed for you, and I prayed for your faith. And so Jesus, in compassion, I believe, looked across the courtyard. That's it. That's what happened. You failed, Peter. But my grace is sufficient. And then Peter ran out of that courtyard, and he wept bitterly. Interesting, another gospel said that the third time he denied him, he cursed. And what he was saying there was, God damn me if I'm with this man. Can you imagine? Can you imagine betraying and denying Jesus like that three times and then saying, cursed. Let me be cursed if I'm with this man. And then Jesus locking eyes with you. And then you running out and weeping bitterly because of your failure. Now, I want to tell you some things about roosters. I'm a city boy from Chicago, so I'll give you some rooster crows that are not accurate rooster crows. But Jesus was betrayed three times. And he predicted, remember, that on the third betrayal, third denial, the rooster was going to crow. So get this. Three things about roosters I want to tell you this morning. I know. First of all about this rooster crow is this. First thing, church history tells us that Peter's denial was broadcast throughout Jerusalem. It's a well-known story. So much so that after Peter became an apostle and was leading a pillar of the New Testament church, he'd walk the streets of Jerusalem, and he'd either be preaching or going to the temple, and there'd be enemies of Christianity, enemies of Peter. And you know what they'd be doing? On his tailcoats, on his robe, right behind him, they'd be going, do-do-do-do-do, like that. Rooster crow. And what did that do for Peter? Reminded him of his failure. But you know what else it did for Peter? It kept him humble. It kept him with his guard up. And he said, I'll never say never again. And I'm going to be dependent on the Lord. And I'm going to stay close to my Savior. I'm not going to follow Jesus from a distance. I need him. God is opposed to the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. I'm going to clothe myself with humility. And I'm going to be a humble man that keeps his guard up and never thinks, I'll never do that again. No, 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 no. He was careful from that day forward. That's the first thing I want to tell you about the rooster. It was a crow that followed him the rest of his life as he did ministry, and enemies followed him with the rooster crow. Second thing I want to tell you about the rooster is this, is that not only did it keep Peter humble, but it reminded Peter of the sovereignty of God. God knew ahead of time. Remember, in John chapter 13, 38, Jesus answered, will you lay down your life for me? Truly, truly, I say to you, a rooster will not crow until you deny me three times. Now, what are the chances? What are the chances that as soon as he denies him the third time, all of a sudden, whoop, doo-doo-doo, like that? It was under the sovereignty of God. Now, what does this tell you, that rooster crow? It's not only something that God knew ahead of time, but God knew. That Peter was going to fail. It didn't surprise God. It didn't catch God unaware, Peter's failure. You know what, church? Let me tell you something. Newsflash. God's not surprised by your failures either. And God is not up in heaven to say, oh, I shouldn't have chosen that person to be a part of my family. Look at the knucklehead things. No, no. It says in Psalm 103, verses 13 and 14, just as a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. For he himself knows our frame. He's mindful that we're just dust. God is not surprised at your mistakes. God is not in heaven scolding you because you're dust and you make mistakes in a sinful world. God's grace is sufficient. And God loves us in spite of our failures. The Bible says even when we're faithless, God is faithful because he cannot deny himself. And I don't know about you, but I say praise God for that. I praise God that he's a father in heaven whose loving kindness is even higher than the heavens towards us. He knows we're going to make mistakes. It doesn't surprise him. And he loves you anyways. Why? Because he's your Abba. He loves you. You know, my kids still make mistakes. They're all grown up on me. One of the mistakes is they all left Lexington. Stop it! So just stayed around home. But my kids make mistakes. Do I stop loving them? Do I stop encouraging them? Do I stop having a relationship with them when they make mistakes? No. I love them anyways. And they do the same for me too, because I'm just an earthly father that makes mistakes, and my parenting still too. But God loves us in spite of ourselves. We learned that from the rooster crow. Hey, last thing about the rooster crow. When does a rooster crow? Huh? In the morning. When does a rooster crow? When the sun rises. And there's some implication in here. This is really cool. I love Scripture. It's so rich, so deep. There's some implication here that God chose a rooster after Peter's denial Because in a way, Jesus was saying with the rooster crow, there's a new day coming, Peter. I'm going to rise. This is Friday with the cross. When the cross hits, this is a Friday. But Peter, Sunday's coming. You warmed yourself by the enemy's fire, but John chapter 21, in just a couple chapters, you're going to warm yourself by my fire. And not only are you going to warm yourself by my fire, but I'm going to restore you, Peter. And I'm going to use you. I got big plans for you. My future for you is not for calamity, it's for welfare. You're going to have a future and a hope, Peter. And not only are you going to have a future and a hope, but Peter, oh, Peter, you're going to preach. You're going to have some fire. You warmed yourself by my fire. You're going to have some fire. And 3,000 people are going to be saved in one day because you're preaching. And Peter, you're going to stand before those same religious leaders that crucified me, and you're going to say, we must obey God rather than men. We ain't stopping no preaching at all. We're all in, man. We are all in. And Peter was for the rest of his life because a new day with the rooster crow was coming. Isn't that wonderful? And Peter went on to write 1 and 2 Peter. Peter went on to become one of the pillars of the New Testament church. Peter went on to be the one who walked up a hill with a cross. And as they were about to crucify him, martyred for the kingdom of God, he said, I'm not worthy to die the death of the Lord's death in the same way. Crucify me upside down. And he was crucified upside down because he was so all in for Jesus Christ. New day. Rooster crow. Beautiful, isn't it? And you know what? I don't care where you've been or what you've done. If any man is in Christ, he's a new creation. The old is gone, the new has come. I don't care what dirt you've been involved with. If you love Jesus right now, the Bible says in Lamentations chapter 3, verse 22, the Lord's loving kindnesses indeed never cease. His compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. And just as the rooster crows at the beginning of a new day, realize every day with Jesus, it's a new day. Because his mercies are new every morning. And I think that'd be a good time for an amen, church. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we just thank you so much, God, for your love, your mercies that are new every morning. It's amazing. It's amazing, God, that you love sinners like us, and you love us so much that you call us your adopted sons and daughters. You love us so much that your steadfast love is new every morning, and your mercies, they never come to an end, God. You love us so much, Father, that even when we fail, even when we make mistakes like Peter did in denying you three times, you have a new day coming. And it's a day of grace. It's a day of mercy. It's a day of using us in spite of ourselves. It's a day where you have big plans for every single person in this room. And I believe that, God. I believe that every single person in this room has a calling and a gifting that you want to use for your kingdom and your glory and the furtherance of your kingdom, God. And Father, help us to remember that our relationship with you isn't based on our performance, God. It's based upon your grace. Our relationship with you is based upon your love for us. And what you want from us more than anything is just a love relationship where we're all in, loving you with all our heart, all our mind, all our soul, and all our strength. Father, forgive us for our half-hearted Christianity. Help us to be all in, God. Forgive us for our pride, Lord. And Father, help us to be people that aren't overconfident or prideful, but humble, Lord, dependent upon you. Help us to be people of prayer, God, people that seek your face on a daily basis so we have that public power from the private prayer. And Father, help us too, Lord, not to warm ourselves at the fires of this world, Lord. Help us to receive fire from you, Jesus. Help our comfort not to be the stuff of this world, but our relationship with you. Help us to be people also that are careful with our associations, Lord. It's so much easier for the world to pull us in if we're not careful. We're called to be holy people, a royal priesthood, a people for your own possession. Help us to live that way, God, by staying close in fellowship with one another, Lord. And Father, for those people that are out there that we do have relationship with that are in the world, Lord, help us to influence them instead of them influencing us, God. Help us to say to them, follow me as I follow Christ. Help us to be witnesses for your kingdom, God, even this week, Lord. Just thank you for this Sunday, Lord, we can be in your word. Thank you for the power that's a part of corporate worship and corporate study of your word, God. Thank you that we feed upon your word, God. We don't live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from your mouth, Lord. Help us not just to be hearers of your word this week, Lord. Help us to be doers. Give us power. Give us power, Lord, to be victors in our daily lives, Lord, because we're connected to you, Jesus. Father, I pray for anybody that might be here this morning that's struggling, someone who might be stuck in sin right now or a habit or some kind of stronghold. God, in Jesus' name, I pray for them. I pray that they might come to your throne of grace and confess it, get real with you, Lord, and be honest. Seek your forgiveness, forsake it, and just repent, Lord. You say times of refreshing come from repentance, Lord. So wash over us with just a spirit of repentance, Lord. A spirit of authenticity where we're going to be transparent and real with you, God. And if there are people here this morning that need to bring some things, that need to be some strongholds that need to be broken, I pray that you would do that right now. And just confess, be honest with God, and then say, I'm done. I'm not going to continue in that area. I repent. The Bible says if you confess your sins, he is faithful, he's just. He will forgive and he'll purify you from all unrighteousness. He'll cleanse you. And Father, I pray that you just be cleansing right now through the blood of Christ. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for the new day that we have with you, the day of grace. Thank you, Jesus, that you didn't stay in that grave. You rose from the grave. You gave Peter a new beginning. And every day is a new beginning with you, Lord. Your mercies are new every morning. Thank you, Lord. And we pray these things now in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Church, let's all